Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. When many of us think of waves, we think of water ones like what surfers ride. There are many other types of waves that are all around us and make up a huge part of how we experience the world and how our technology works. In this video, we'll introduce 5 common wave types, which are radio waves, microwaves, infrared waves, visible light waves, and sound waves. Even though each of these wave types are different than each other, they have some things in common. For each type of wave that we discuss, we'll answer 3 questions. 1. How do we experience the wave? 2. What does the wave travel through? And 3. How long is the wave? Let's start by learning 3 vocabulary words about waves: the crest, the trough, and the wavelength. The word crest refers to the top of something, like the yellow feather on the head of this yellow-crested cockatoo. The word trough refers to an upward-facing curve. This has a similar shape to a water trough that farmers use to give animals water. Each wave is made up of a crest and a trough. One wave goes from the beginning of the crest to the end of the trough. We call that distance the wavelength. It's easiest to find a wavelength by measuring the distance between 2 crests. For example, if we wanted to know the wavelength of these water waves, we would measure the distance between their crests, which is 8 inches. For this introductory video, we'll use familiar units of length, but in general, we measure wavelengths using the metric system. You don't have to memorize any wavelengths, but it's helpful to have a general idea of how long they are for reasons that we'll explain shortly. The first of the 5 wave types we'll introduce are radio waves. Our car radios receive radio waves, which they turn into sound. Our TVs receive radio waves that they turn into sound and video. Our smartphones receive radio waves that they display as text messages or turn into the sounds of our friends talking to us. Our smartphones can also make radio waves of the messages we write or the sound of our voice that they then send to our friends. We use radio waves in almost all of our remote control devices. That includes everything from controlling toy cars to locking a real car using a key fob. Radio waves are used by pilots to talk with air traffic control personnel and by the radar that tracks all planes and other objects in the air. Radio waves travel through the air, but they can also travel through some solid material like glass windows and walls. That's why we can talk inside, and yet the radio waves can go through the walls to cell towers. Radio waves are excellent at traveling through outer space. That's why satellites in outer space can send signals to people who have satellite TV subscriptions. Outer space has no air. When a space has no air or other things in it that we can detect, we call that a vacuum. This means that radio waves are very good at traveling in a vacuum. Although we cannot see radio waves, we have ways to measure their wavelength. The first radios used AM radio waves. Each AM radio wave is about the length of an old-fashioned train. Then came TV, which also used radio waves to bring sound and images to people's homes. But those radio waves are shorter. They're about 12 feet long. Then came FM radio. Each FM radio wave is about 9 feet long. Then came mobile cell phones. Radio waves used by cell phones are only 6 inches long. Wavelength is what distinguishes radio waves from each other. For example, if a radio tower makes waves with wavelengths that are each hundreds of feet long, then it will be sending signals that only AM radios can receive and play. On the other extreme, if a radio tower makes waves with wavelengths of only 6 inches, then only cell phones will be able to receive those signals. This means that a wave's length is a major part of what we use that wave for. Next, we'll introduce microwaves. We frequently use microwave ovens to heat up food or drinks. Microwave ovens generate microwaves. Each microwave is about 4 inches long. Microwaves can go through air, solids, and liquids. That's why they can heat up food and drinks. They can also go through vacuums very well. Next, we'll introduce infrared waves. There are 2 types of infrared waves we commonly experience. The first one is associated with heat. If you've ever been sick, someone might have checked you for a fever using a touchless thermometer like these. Touchless thermometers work by detecting infrared waves. We, like all objects, are giving off infrared waves all the time. The infrared waves radiating from our bodies and for most objects around us, have a wavelength of about 1/8 the width of a human hair. We often use infrared thermometers to check the surface temperature of objects, like this engine. These images are from an infrared camera and a regular camera. The infrared camera shows the coldest objects in blue and the hottest ones in white. This is useful for seeing where a building might be leaking heat and needs insulation. We make infrared waves when we heat things up. This heat lamp generates light that we can see, plus infrared waves that we can't see. A space heater also generates infrared waves that we can't see. About half of the waves from the sun that reach the Earth are infrared waves. This is one of the ways how the sun keeps our planet warm. Since the sun's infrared waves have to go through outer space to reach the Earth, this tells us that infrared waves can travel through a vacuum. Another common type of infrared wave are those that we use in TV remote controls. Unlike radio waves that easily go through walls, infrared waves are more limited. Although we can't see these infrared waves, many of our devices can, such as this smartphone's camera. The wavelength for these infrared waves are much shorter than those measured by infrared thermometers. They're about twice the width of visible light waves, which we'll discuss next. Now, we'll introduce visible light waves. When we see a rainbow, we are seeing individual colors of light. Visible light is also made of waves. It's the wavelength of light that determines what color that light is. For example, visible light waves with the shortest wavelengths are violet and the longest wavelengths are red, with all other colors having unique wavelength values in between those wavelengths. To get an idea for the size of an average wavelength of light, here's a magnified human hair. The space between these two arrows is about the thickness of one visible light wave. About 2,000 visible light waves can fit end-to-end in 1 millimeter. Visible light goes through some liquid, which is why we can see sunlight when we're underwater. Visible light can go through some solid materials like glass. And light is very good at going through vacuums like outer space. That's why the light waves from the sun can reach the Earth and make our days bright. In future videos, we'll show how all of the prior waves we discussed are closely related. That means radio waves of all types, microwaves, infrared waves, and visible light waves are almost identical to each other. A key difference among them is their wavelengths. The last wave type we'll discuss are sound waves. These are unrelated to the four waves we just introduced, but they're still waves, so they have wavelengths. Every time we hear something, we are detecting sound waves. When we talk, the pitch of our voices is carried by sound waves that are about 6 feet long, which is close to our average heights. High-pitched sounds, like a bird's chirp, are carried by sound waves that have a short wavelength. These high-pitched sound waves are about 2 inches long. Low-pitched sounds, like this line is making, are carried by sound waves that have long wavelengths. These low-pitched sound waves are about 10 feet long. It's the length of a sound wave that determines if we hear high-pitch or low-pitch noises. We know that sound waves can go through the air very easily because that's how we hear almost everything. Whales can talk to each other, so we know sound waves travel through water. We can hear traffic outside, even when the doors and windows are closed. So we know sound waves can travel through solid objects like walls and glass, at least a little bit. But do you think sound waves can travel through vacuums like outer space? To answer that question, let's do an experiment. This pot and lid are called a vacuum chamber. This is a vacuum pump. It's like a very strong vacuum cleaner because it can suck air through this tube and pump it out the backside. When we connect the pump to the lid, the pump sucks out the air. We'll put this alarm clock inside the vacuum chamber and remove the air. When all the air is pumped out of the vacuum chamber, we cannot hear the alarm ringing, but it's easy to hear this man's finger tap on the table. This answers our question. Sound waves cannot travel in a vacuum. We'll turn this valve to let the air back inside, and as the air enters, now we can hear the alarm ringing. This shows us that when there is air around the alarm clock, then sound waves can reach us so we can hear the alarm clock. Of the five wave types we introduced in this video, only sound waves cannot travel in a vacuum. Here's a summary of this video and some additional information. Please pause this video to read this if you wish. Thanks for your attention.